There we go.
Like Amy said, this is a project that actually had two seasons of fieldwork, but there are two seasons that actually happened before that I want to talk briefly about. And I want to, if you don't mind, talk about 40 minutes or so and then ask questions. And this, again, I can't take credit at all for hardly any of this. I was one of many, mostly from the Museum of Nature and Science, the Colorado State University, the Center for Environmental Management with Military Lands under Colorado, and of course, under the DPAA. Is that bugging y'all, that bar over here?
It's not on the feed, right? It's just on yours.
It's on your, it's on my circle.
We can move it, yeah. Want me to move it for
you? Do you think I know how to do this?
I got you.
Okay. Stay in school. No. All right. So a word on full disclosure, and that is because this is an ongoing project, I'm not actually going to talk about the results of the finds. I'll talk about everything basically but the human remains associated or not associated with this project. And that's just at the discretion because whatever research is out and happening is still doing DNA analysis, and the family needs to be the first to be informed of that information. So I'm going to just talk around that bit. But I think the story is compelling enough to really sort of I'm trained as a prehistorian. I work in the U.S. Southwest. I'm Chacoanist. So doing a B-17 bomber pilot who was downed on July the 8th of 1944 is a whole different methodology, a whole different worldview. And working under the auspices of a military organization, the DPA, as Amy was saying, was a totally huge learning curve, I think, for lots of us, for a lot of reasons. Good, bad, I think, and good, bad, weird.
Yeah,
and all of the above. So that's just a word. There's no sort of denouement to this. So like I said, there's going to be very little associated with human remains. I do teach the archaeology of death. I love death of really, really ancient people, which I understand that that's not what we're talking about now. And I know there are very, very different sensibilities. John's laughing. I'm used to teaching undergrads, but you were just as badly behaved. So anyway, we're doing something a little bit differently. So I just pulled together just a little bit of a edited version of the film that the DPA is. And maybe just me, I didn't know about this organization until about 2018 or 2019. And this is a huge organization based out of Hawaii. It's gone under a variety of different names, different acronyms, and I cannot play the acronym word soup game with you tonight, so I won't. But it's known now as the DPA. And basically they are charged with finding some 88,000 missing service members all the way back from, mostly from World War I, World War II, at Vietnam and Korea. And the majority of those missing members are from World War II. So they are charged with the identification of those who are missing, the search and recovery of their remains, the identification and DNA and genetic analysis of who they are, and then the reinterment or burial, honorable burial of their remains. And so again, there's POW, MIA, you are not forgotten, but these were our partners and our directors in this project, even though this is my understanding, they're now partnering organizations like the Denver Museum of Nature and Science and Colorado State University because they need more resources, because they want to find more missing service members out there. And that's how Amy and I got involved in this project. So sorry, some point, nobody has two AAA batteries, do they? Give you a nickel. Two nickels? No nickels. Okay. So there again, there are 84,000 service members missing. I think that number since I have looked has decreased. On average, they find between 30 and 40 service members a year and identify them. So it's a long haul, and the budgets for this and the amount of money that's put into this is kind of telling of the priority this is for the Department of Defense. As a side note, it is also a very sort of lucrative job it's a career path for some people who want to sort of go into archaeology. So the object of our story today is, don't point it at me. Nobody wants to see this. Okay, I'm standing here. This is Lieutenant George Wilson Jr. He was known as Frankie. He was born on November 13th, 1921. When he enlisted, he was 146 pounds, 5'6", blue eyes, brown hair. And he was the service member to whom we spent this time sort of searching. So what we knew and what we sort of got the papers, oh, bless your little hearts, I mean that in all the ways. So what we know is that George Wilson's plane went down on July 8th in 1944. He was very likely, and I'll talk about this in a minute, killed in flight and Every one of his crew was able to bail out and parachute safely to ground. All but one of them were captured by German forces. One of them escaped with the help of the French resistance. And we were working at a little site called Machi Caillou, where the bread is excellent and the vending machines have baguettes. This was pretty great. This isn't going to work, is it? Why would this work? This wouldn't work. Technology is not your friend.
Your backup batteries?
There's no love for Erin today. I'm not, okay. The world of Erin. Ma'am, sir, whoever.
I got two more if you want to try these.
Ready? Okay. So what we're looking at is comedy bears is this great sort of technology that actually worked, which was the B-17 bomber. This evolved into sort of other iterations, and this was the major projection of force that the world that service members had during this time period. And there's actually a history of it, and I think I have a tiny bit of a. We're doing things. This is like smooth, like butter. So here is the.
No, it's not gonna be a great film.
So this is the crew that was all associated instead. So this is the crew that was associated with, and there's the plane that we were looking for. Frankie was down here on the bottom left. Sorry about the resolution, but we actually don't have great. We've been working with the family, but we don't have sort of great primary resources on all this information. So you might know the Memphis Belle. This is a B-24 bomber, sort of the same thing. And you know that the big thing was to do 20 missions and to survive. And that early on in the war from 1941 to 1944 was very uncommon. It was incredibly high casualty rates because anything and everything would often go wrong in the air. And this was this is very unlikely story. I mean, the Memphis Belle was really super unusual because the life expectancy for these service members was really quite low. I think I have a statistic later that the death rate for the 8th Air Force was higher than the US Marines in the Pacific theater. Yeah, so here is a little bit about.
The B-17 was an outgrowth of military strategies following the First World War, where armies hunkered down for months in the trenches, battling in the mud, fighting for inches of territory at the cost of millions of lives. By the mid-30s, the demands for a supreme military weapon take shape.
The U.S. Army Air Corps wants a modern bomber. They want something with the range, the altitude, and the speed capable of delivering a load of bombs on a target. It's their vision of what future war will be.
In 1935, the Boeing Company develops a breakthrough four-engine, long-range aircraft that can carry a 2-ton bomb load and is heavily armed, the B-17. The excitement generated by the B-17 leads many air power advocates to claim the bomber could fly anywhere, unescorted. In flight, the B-17 is a formidable fighting machine, operated by a 10-man crew, each one with a specific job.
In the front of the airplane, you have the bombardier. His job is to drop the bombs in the bomb bay in the center of the aircraft on the target. The navigator's job is to guide the airplane to the target. The two pilots right behind them guide the airplane, operate it, fly it. The radio operator on a B-17 performs the critical function of communicating with the other bombers in the formation. For the rest of the airplane, it's all about the defensive armament and employing that in defense of the airplane. The top turret gunner, the waist guns, the ball turret on the bottom, and the tail turret all defend the aircraft against enemy attack.
That should give you sort of a sense of the historical antecedents. And again, these are sort of the statistics that normally died in the Eighth Army.
We can't hear you.
I don't know what to do about that. Can I talk? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay.
There may be a delay between the video setting off and the
I'll sit quiet. Perfect. My big head will be in the way, but we'll just go with it. Can you guys, can adapt? Okay.
Yeah.
So, all right. More than 1 million, German men were, and 400,000 guns were set to meet them. So you can imagine, but it's not just the guns that are the problem. Any mechanical issue any sort of problem with oxygen, these men are flying at sometimes 32,000 feet. It's minus 50 degrees. Anytime when their oxygen is freezes up, which it often did, they're having to fly in really close formation. So any sort of time that they clip each other's wings or anybody gets in the way, fuel problems, navigational problems. There's a story of one pilot that thought the Sahara Desert was the Mediterranean and flew into southern Libya, and the guys tried to hike out, it never worked. So it's just, it's just super, super dangerous and really difficult to do. And here is what this pilot, sort of what these planes looked like. And they evolved. So the one that Lieutenant Wilson was flying was a B-17G, which had been sort of modified and upgraded and for a number of reasons. By the time that they were flying, they were still flying in very tight formation because air superiority had not been gained over the European theater. So they still had to defend themselves. And I'll show you what that formation would have looked like at the time. Later, they were able to sort of spread out and it was less sort of perilous to do work there. I have just a video. There was a B-17 bomber that actually visited Denver two summers ago. And the team science scholars from Denver Museum went out. And you can just give you an idea of the sort of the cramped condition that these men were working in. They would often get up at 2 to 3 o'clock in the morning to have a breakfast. They were always mad the British guys got better breakfast than they did. Just reading their journals. They're 19, 20, 21-year-old kids, and they're doing this every day. And that's the casualty rate is extraordinary. But they're getting into this thing, and then they're taking off, and then they're flying in circles sometimes for hours to get the other planes up and in formation and set to go. So, and they're meanwhile, they're just cold and in these sort of conditions. Oftentimes, they're like, Bobby forgot his glove, and his hand's frozen off, and Timmy's hungover, and, you know, all the stories in their journals of what it's like to be sort of a young man under these conditions. So Frankie, again, was, this is, I think, a little bit of his story. He was born in Utah, outside of Utah, to this really sort of lovely mother and father. There's his grandson-in-law. In 2019, he, of his own volition and of his own money, he's an Army veteran. He went out to France with sort of notes and notations that he sort of cobbled together, talked to locals who saw the plane come down in 44, and kind of petitioned from the data that he found and from a little bit of digging and a little bit of work that he did with these men, found part of what could have been a military plane. He didn't find anything diagnostic that would have been, you know, a number or a serial number assigned to that particular plane. But between the oral history, the general maps, the history of Frankie's compatriots and giving an idea of where that plane went down, they had a pretty good sense of it. He then contacted Orrin Hatch, who was senator at Utah, and he forwarded and raised sort of Lieutenant Wilson's profile in the DPAA history. And that's why by 2020, a sort of a survey team was sent out to sort of go and look. And this is all helped by this guy who was Pierre. What was his name? There was the, he had the great name. It was like the jackal, but it wasn't. It was the the gremlin, the goblin, the goblin. So he is a really prolific journalist who writes in French and English. He's very into archaeology. He lives in a manor just over the hill. And he would come out every day and sort of help us to see what was going on. So he really sort of helped with that. And here is young Frankie, again, born November 13th in 1921. I think this is playing a movie. Cute, very cute kid. He grew up in Utah and California, and he moved all other places. He enlisted. He was an Eagle Scout, as you probably well know. And he was, I think at some point, college bound, but he ended up with there's his sister. She lived in Utah until very recently. She died in 2005. She had a very successful auto industry, and there's his mom who was wonderful. He did have a son, and I think he was estranged from his wife at the time of his death. His son was born in 1942. His mom never sort of forgot Frankie, nor did his sister. They said they remembered him every day. That's his young son. I think there's a photo of them side by side. His son just passed away in 2017. His name is Terry, and they actually just look identical. But I don't think Frankie got to know his son very well. But he is the object of our search during this time. So here is the field that Amy and I spent an extraordinary amount of time in. It is idyllic. There are Jersey cows and Frenchmen with baguettes and nuns with beer and cheese. And there's also a castle. The Battle of Agincourt is like 30 miles that way. But if you look closely, you can see that there's significant bomb craters still to this day, 70 years after the fact. And why would anyone want to bomb a French countryside? Well, there were these things called V1 rockets that were being sent over into London right around the time Frankie and his crew were going out there. And one of the things that they were meant to do was suppress these V1 rockets, but I'll get to those in a second. So in 2019, Frankie's step grandson, he's married to grandniece. And they went out and they sort of did an official survey and they started sort of find more and more pieces to get them a sense. And they did do some excavations, they did some preliminary mapping, and they definitely found pieces associated with warfare from World War II. Again, the diagnostics were a little more difficult, but the goblin wrote it up, got more interest, and consequently this was moved to the next phase from the survey phase into the, we're gonna go whole hog on this and we're gonna really throw some resources and some archaeologists behind it to really kind of give a sense of what this was. I wanna pause on the excavation though and just give you a little context of what the 8th Air Force was all about. We take it for granted, anyone born, I don't know, after 1951, what the 8th Air Force was. The Air Force was in its infancy. If you think Kitty Hawk was what, 1903, and we have long range bombers by 1933, this is an extraordinary rise in technology. The Army had to sort of make it up new all on its own, and it was an incredibly complicated sort of system. And if anybody saw that movie Pearl Harbor, you might've seen Hap Arnold, played by Alec Baldwin, I think. Hap Arnold was the head of this and he was the brains behind the operation. It was a huge operation and don't expect to read this. I boiled it down for you. I'm fully intent upon cliff notes. 52 generals, 33 who had sort of direct supervisory sort of jobs with, and this is again, this is just one of 13 or 14 armies that were involved in World War II. All of these sort of had to be, so basically for every guy in a plane, there were 10 guys on the ground, making sure he had fuel, he had ammunition, he was fed and warm at night, and he was taken care of if he was injured, plus a million other things that I don't even sort of am aware of about. So, and then there were all of these air forces, and then our, you know, very important 8th, which was the one that saw the most action in the European theater, even more than the Pacific, and was probably even more key to sort of the eventual victory in Europe, if I do say so myself. I should say my dad's Air Force, my uncle's Air Force, my other uncle's Army, but we don't talk about it. Okay, so here is the types of planes that were in the 8th Air Force. It wasn't just bombers, they had support groups, they had refuelers, they had fighter groups. Fighters had much less of a range and could only escort bombers so far over the sort of the European theater. Once they had to peel off, and that's when these were terrible sort of bombing runs that were happening over Germany that were killing hundreds. I mean, they were taking down, at one point there were 80 B-17s that were taken down in a single day. So it's, and each of those had a 10 man crew. So you can imagine the losses were extraordinary. But they did their best to sort of support the B-17s with these sort of smaller fighter jets. Here's what the B-17 sort of looked like in profile. You get a sense of this thing. I memorized the statistics before I came over here about the wingspan and the fuel range. It's fallen straight out of my head. They're huge. Is it okay? You want me to, I have it in my notebook. You're okay. All right. Thank you. Okay. So that's what it looks like.
The B-17 was an American bomber. It carried a payload of over 4,000 pounds of bombs. The problem with this bomber and all bombers is that they were big, slow, and loud. German fighters and anti-aircraft guns wreaked havoc with the bombers. Flak, or anti-aircraft fire, was a nightmare that affected almost every bomber in World War II. These were rounds that would explode near a bomber, throwing pieces of shrapnel at them. Bombers could take evasive maneuvers, but at times it was so thick, they just had to fly through it. To combat the enemy fighters, the B-17 had 9 machine gun positions. These bombers often flew in large groups that were escorted by American fighter planes, like the
B-17. So, contrary to popular belief, the gunners on a B-17 rarely hit, let alone down another fighter. They were just too fast. They were just deterrents to keep the fighters from just flipping them out of the sky. So if fighters honed in on B-17s and they had no air support, there was very little they can do. And that's where often many of the planes were shot down. So I do have some footage, and this might be disturbing to some of you, but there is some footage of planes that were filming other planes as they were shot down. almost every squadron had at least one camera mounted in the turret, the front turret of its plane. So they were able to sort of record a number of these sort of air-to-air battles. And these are all early on. I tried to get these from pre-1943 and just sort of the level of chaos that would have been happening. And imagine, you know, if you're a pilot, your sight is limited, you know, to a range of about 70 degrees in front of you if you're a tail gunner. But by golly, the waist gunners and the ball turret at the bottom had the highest level of mortality, as you can imagine. They were often sort of targeted, and the tail gunner too was often targeted by pilots. But the one thing that was potentially good about B-17s was that they flew at such great heights that when and if they were shot down, the crew had a chance of escaping. And often if you made it out, and then again, you had often, sometimes like the ball turret gunner, the guy in the base, he went into that turret without a parachute. So imagine being shot down 32,000 feet. You got to take your oxygen off, try not to pass out, get out of the ball turret, get your parachute on and get out. Meanwhile, the plane is spinning out of control. So these are sort of the challenges that these crews would have found and why there were so many pilots and crew who were in who were in prison encampments in Germany, because like in Lieutenant Wilson's case, 8 of the 9 of the guys made it out, made it out and were captured. One guy sort of escaped, but just to give you a sense of all that. And the B-17s were incredibly rugged. They were more popular than the later B-24s, which had a longer range, had a bigger carrying capacity, but were more complex. They had more sort of hydraulics and electronics, more things to go wrong. But these early ones, there was a fighter that ripped through this plane and it still landed, the All-American still in it. With you, Mason, this is a big deal. And there are lots of these where the whole nose cone would have been ripped off. And the pilots were still through skill, and the basics of this machine were able to sort of still land it. So it took a lot to bring it down, and then it didn't take a lot to bring it down. It's this, And these are the main antagonists to the B-17. This is the FW-190, known as the Fokker, and I forgot to look up this other one. Does anyone know this German fighter? The 12, yeah. Fokker Messerschmitt?
Messerschmitt was a 109.
It was 109, okay.
Yeah, and the single engine, like the Fokker. The Fokker was a heavier, actually preferred by the Germans.
Okay.
It was a heavier fighter and had more range. And was, it could take more. The Messerschmitt was more of a patriot to the Spitfire of the British.
Gotcha.
The twin engine fighter wasn't very popular because it was, as you can see, it had a bigger cockpit and as a result it carried a bigger crew. And they often used it as an attack aircraft as opposed to the fighter.
Do you want to switch?
my uncle was a 17 and 24 pilot.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, please holler out when if I do him or anyone else injustice. Okay. I don't know what that was. So here we're going to get to some excavation. So this is when we finally flew into Paris and we took all of our gear with us. This is in the middle of COVID. So this is 2021. Yes. And we did, all the things. And so those are students from CSU. And we had these great vans that we would sort of drive out into this idyllic setting of fog and cows. And again, this is where we were sort of working. The problem was this field was under cultivation at the time we arrived. So a crew, about 5 of us arrived a few days early and we went out to see what we could see. And what we could see was when we put, you know, we're looking for this sort of things. And again, you can see this idyllic area bombed to snodgrass and back. And the reason was, and you can see the sort of the bombed craters on the hillside still to this day. And that's again, because of the V1 rockets, but where the plane potentially landed is in that field of rapeweed and spiders and barbed wire and other sound. So this is it's sort of like for me, it's kind of pet high. And so we didn't know where to start. We had a few rough maps from the 2020 crew. So we just kind of went out and it was kind of like throw a pin in the ground and see what we could see, what we came up with. And so immediately the neighbor started coming out and saying, I have this strut from a B-17 at my house. And I'm pretty sure my dad said there's an engine in our backyard that sort of flew away. So we ended up sort of carving out a little space, and we ended up doing a test excavation. It was so wet, it rained almost every day there. We pulled out different soils and tried to get them to dry because they were so wet, we couldn't get them through the screen to be able to find artifacts. And so we put them in buckets, we put them on tarps, we put them, I don't know what we did. We covered our body in mud. It was pretty much kind of how it was. And this was the experience of it. Yeah. And I was so lazy, I just tried to fly the drone and get out of all the work. But this is essentially, so you can see the different methods of drying that we were doing. And then people over there were trying to screen. And again, this is like literal needle in a haystack in the middle of this huge field next to a castle by the abbey. And the, so we're coming up with metal and things like that, but we're coming up with medieval metal. We're coming up with metal from the Battle of Agincourt. We're coming up with all kinds of things. So this is an idea of sort of the general sort of conditions. So what we needed was we needed to knock down that rape weed, and we needed metal detectors to help us sort of pinpoint where things were. And that is a literal pile of poop that was steaming. So anyway, that could give you an idea of what it was. I think I made a film to just show my pity. This is me screaming in the rain. I'm going to fast forward this because this is just me being sad and alone. I think you are.
I'm off screen.
So if you can imagine, I'm not only leaving this on to see my humiliations and slowness of my old woman age, but this is a bag of wet dirt. If you have to push through an 8-inch screen. And if you can imagine, there's about 2,000 of these buckets that we have to do for each excavation. And we need to do about 10 excavations. And you see that dirt going through? So you gotta then kind of, you're laughing. No, that's fine, that's fine. So then you gotta sort of push that through and then sort of not spike yourself. And by the way, there's live ammunition. There's potentially live bombs. There's all. So, and then there's spiders. Yeah. So, so this takes one person, me, or maybe not. I'm old, but I'm not unskilled with springing. It took me about 15 minutes to leave the bucket, one bucket. So, you can imagine this got to be onerous. And this isn't even the time it takes to sort of dig the excavation, you know, to map it, do all the drawing, and things like that. Okay. Are we done looking at me looking pitiful? There's a pretty soon the profanity starts, and there's young people in the room. Okay. So, I'm not quite sure what this is. So, we decided, and this is the joys, and I think everyone who works for private or nonprofits, the army just bought the field of rape food. So it was maybe $1,500, something like that. We bought the crop. And so it wasn't quite ready to be harvested. So Francois, I can't remember my French, this is not good.
Xavier,
that was close to Francois. Thank you, Amy. We ended up, we knew we had to sort of, we had to knock all this down. We couldn't metal detect, we couldn't dig into all of this. So we ended up sort of having, do I just do drones for no reason? Really, I didn't want to work. Enough of this. So eventually they did. So they came out and they harvested this crop, and it gave us a significantly more sort of a swath of land to work with. This is only about week two. We only lost about 1 week, so they're in kind of dealing with the spiders and the tiny dots of things. Meanwhile, what was really wonderful was that three men from the village, all in their 70s or 80s, started coming out and saying the plane was over there. The only problem was one said the plane was over there, one said the plane was over there, and one said the plane was over there. And one was 5, one was 13, and one was 9 when it was, and they all had different recollections of it. So we had to sort of back this up by archaeologically found food here. And we couldn't do it with survey. This soil had been churned up for 70 years and cultivated. So we had to do it with the metal detectors. And we had to do it with just basically dropping an excavation unit. We did a 4x4 meter unit on top of what was a concentration. And it was a ton of work. And we begged and pleaded and finally got us a digger to help us because this saved us significant amount of time. But it took us, for one excavation unit, about 9 people, about 2.5 days to screen the dirt. And what was extraordinary was there were a number of skilled people on the, and if we came across any bone whatsoever, and say, for instance, a bone, I remember one day we found on that excavation unit right there, a hollow bone. Do humans have hollow bones? No. Who has hollow bones? first. So, but the protocols are that we need to call somebody in the Philippines. It's 4 o'clock in the morning there. We're like, Lieutenant Colonel, whomever, we have this. Do you trust us? Here's the camera phone. This is a bird bone. And he says, no, we the protocols are you need to dig a whole excavation in there. So I get it. Like, I get there's like, I'm like 4 PhDs and 2 master's students and 19. Okay, we'll dig the bird bone units. So, and again, this is the size of the field that we're doing.
The military works.
Here's the thing. There's give and take everywhere, right?
Design.
They gave us the most amazing equipment, and they brought in like soldiers from and people from the embassy. They gave us resources that we could not have afforded. We stayed at a hotel. They had free breakfast in the morning time. It was like amazing. And then they organized sort of locals to come out. This guy was not as useful as he could have been. But it did become sort of a community endeavor because it was such extraordinary work. It was solemn, but it was also, this is a community event to sort of try to find this young man. Why did I put that in there? Anyway, so this was the kind of things that we would find on a daily basis. So at the end of the day, we would put out everything on the table that we would find. And some of this stuff is explosive and corrosive. And so there are times when we had to call the police. There were times when we had to call the bomb squad. They just had to sort of make sure. At one point, Ray got confused and tried to smash. Anyway, it didn't work. But there were diagnostic things that we were finding with you know, things on tank, there was undiagnostic materials that we're finding, but things that we could make sure were from that exact plane, which was important because there were actually 2 bombers that came down in Machu Picchu in around that same time period in June, July of 1944. So they were about 3 miles apart. So here's the police and the gendarmes who were sort of helping us make sure we were doing this all in safety. We want you to know that we stored the explosive materials in the porta potties overnight so that they were perfectly safe. And this is what an excavation unit looked like. So we dug it in quadrants and then we screened it in quadrants. So we maintained some sort of contextual sorts of data. But we couldn't have gotten this far without the help of, you know, this whole team of metal detectors, local historians, farmers, Amy, your mother, yes, all of them sort of working. And then we put it back at the end. So everything got backfilled. So this was 2021, and they did go back in 2022 to examine it, but neither Amy nor I were there, but we did hear sort of, there's the crew, aren't we adorable? We did also do some ground penetrating radar, some proton magnetometry. We had some people from Holland. Were they from Holland? Belgium. Okay. That's, yes. And they came out and helped. So by the end, we dug about 9 out of the 10 units that we were meant to do, which is pretty good given the weather and the restrictions that we had. There was also stinging nettles. Anybody ever had a stinging? Yeah. You had a stinging nettle? Did it make you burst into tears?
Yeah,
me too. Your mother did not cry. I drank a lot of wine. I'm not quite sure what this video is doing. I might have overdone the drone footage. I'm so sorry. But in the end, we got a sense that there was the plane. We had a really good sense of that. But we didn't have a sense of where the cockpit could have been, where because what we know from the oral history, and that this is from I'm just gonna show you background, is that there's different stories about what happened, but they were flying over, I don't think I have maps. We think that Frankie, Lieutenant Wilson, was probably killed in flight, killed by shrapnel, by flak, while he was flying it. And the plane spiraled down as the men jumped out. And they said they remember they were falling at the same sort of speed that the plane was falling on. And they said as it came into this field, it sort of keeled over to its right wing, nose down, and exploded. So that's what we have from the men on the plane. But then you have different recollections from the eyewitness accounts of the 3 young men who were now in their 70s and 80s. And then you have the eyewitness accounts or the secondary witness accounts of the kids of people who were older there. So they're in their 40s, 50s, 60s. And they said, my dad saw it and it was there. So it was It was collaborative, but it was a really hard collaboration because nothing was really clear. We were looking for indications of burned soil. We were looking for indentations into the earth. And it was just, we didn't quite see what we were hoping for. Here's a sort of a heat map of some of the metal that was found. So every day we made a map of what the metal detectors had found. And they sort of changed through time. So you can see it's in these trees. Off to the lower left is private land, so we weren't allowed to go back there. And then this area wasn't sort of tilled by the time we got there, so we didn't get as far out. But the oral history is that in this lower pink area, it's one landing spot, this pink and red sort of enclave, and then up to the upper left is where where people remember the plane landing. And then, of course, there's stuff scattered all throughout the fields. So it's complex, right? This is a learning while you go kind of a project that was sort of hard to figure. And I think we saw enough of these. We did find sort of things that indicated altimeter. We did find clear indication of, you know, stuff that probably would have been in or near the cockpit. We had a number of service members on the project. Almost all the service members were running the metal detecting, and then several of the leaders were sort of new, sort of to pinpoint where in the cockpit this came from, and that was what we were really looking for because we were pretty sure that Lieutenant Wilson was in the cockpit when the plane went down. And then there was all the other stuff. Okay. And then we put it back. Okay, I got way too overzealous. So what exactly happened under Wyatt? And I think I just alluded to this, but I just want to go through it really quickly, is that this is a photo that was taken on July 8th of the 8th Air Force. I don't know if Frankie's plane is in that group, but these were people he would have known. By the way, he was only on his third mission when he shot down. So this is his third day of being a bombardier. Well, he wasn't bombardier, he was a pilot, but it was his third day in combat. This was his home base. Just outside of Bournemouth, and there was sorry, cover your eyes. There's accounts of sort of, you know, sanctioned parties that the pilots and the crew needed to blow off steam, sort of the ground crew, and sort of what was happening. And there was a big party the day after this loss, which was kind of, there was some thought about replaying it, because during this one bombing run on July the 8th, this particular squadron, the 398th bomb group of the 8th Army, lost their front three planes. So there was some decision about not to do this. So to give you an idea of what was going on in the war, or at least in the European theater part of the war, what I did was I pulled together a map of Normandy for each of the 30 days leading up to this, starting with D-Day. And you can kind of get a sense of, this is what's showing Axis forces, defenses, and then what happens after D-Day. And you'll begin to see sort of these forces move in. It's a little bit longer than this video that I would like, but it kind of gives you an idea of where things are going. And the foci of the war is over in Normandy and far off to the west. But what's happening at the same time is these V1 rockets are being used to launch, to demoralize the citizens of London. They're not targeting military targets, they are targeting civilian populations. And so Lieutenant Wilson and his colleagues aren't working over in this area where there's all this ground support going with them. They're working over in this area off to the east where these rockets are going, where their defenses are untouched by ground forces, where they're in full retaliatory and defensive mode to sort of stop this. Did it make it all the way through? No, still going.
How close is that area to the Pas de Calais?
How close is that
to the Pas de
Calais? It's
where the V1s were.
So you see the sign, it's up far, it's just off and to the right.
Okay.
Yeah. I had to go back to my French. It didn't work there, did you? Yes. So where are we up to? July 10th. So we just passed the 8th. So that was the date. July 8th is the day that Lieutenant Wilson was down. Okay. So again, V1 and V2 rockets are these bombs of terror. I mean, they're not weapons of war, they're weapons of civilian casualties. And they're basically flying bombs. They're an explosive device with a fuel rocket associated with it. And I think I have a video, just a really brief one, of what I might not want to do it.
In 1942, the Luftwaffe, aware of the development of a long-range rocket by the German army, began intensive development of a rival weapon,
A ramjet flying bomb. The flying bomb entered service ahead of the Army's rocket and became known as the V-1. Launched from ramps situated in the Pas de Calais, flying bombs were used to attack London in an offensive that commenced on June the 13th, 1944. Basically simple in design, the flying bomb was an economical and effective weapon of war. Traveling at speeds of up to 440 miles per hour, it severely tested the air defenses of England. In early September 1944, the flying bomb launch sites were overrun by advancing Allied armies. In a three-month offensive, the bombs killed over 5,000 Londoners, maiming and wounding many thousands more.
So those launch pads were what the army and the 398 bomb group was going after. It wasn't right there in Monte Cayu, but it was at another site called Pinay. That's not right. Pinay? Pinay. Go with me on this. So here's sort of the statistics of what the V1 kind of did. And you can see that it was just incredibly destructive. My parents bought me a desk for graduation, and I don't know where it came from, but I opened up the back of it and there's a newspaper article from 1944 and a photograph of three deceased humans on a London street. And I don't know what to do with this, but it was in my desk and it's been there for however many years I've had that desk. But I would imagine that it's something similar to either the 1940 Blitz or the 1944 V1 rockets free. But June, if you can imagine, you know, June the 13th, when this sort of started, it's right after the invasion of Normandy. And this is what Churchill demanded that the army, sort of the Eighth Army Air Corps, go out and take care of, not supporting the troops on the ground who were invading Normandy. So it was this huge fight in the upper echelons of the Allied forces. And Lieutenant Wilson was right on the forefront of that, sort of supporting neither, right? The air guys weren't supporting the ground troops and the ground troops weren't supporting the air guys, but they split their differences and suffered casualties because of it. So the V1 rocket sites, I think I do a thing up here where the V1, it's hard to see because of that, but the V1 rocket sites are up in that area. And this is, I don't know, Amy, if you ever got to go up there, but this is the remains of the concrete launch pads that are in those trees. They're still there to this day, just kind of, and it feels like a swamp over there. I think I have Machi Cayu on my phone now for weather, and I think it does rain literally every day.
The ramps are still there?
The ramps are still there. They're broken, but the concrete ramps and the bunkers are still there. And I think I'm going to climb down into one of these bunkers. That's Teddy Roosevelt's great, great, great grandkid, I think, climbing in to one of these. So they were really, and early on the V1s, they needed those huge launch pads. The V2s didn't need that same sort of visible element. So these were really well camouflaged because they just got obliterated. And there's a town just a few miles away that is the most bombed place on the planet. And you look at it in the photographs, aerial photographs in the 1940s, and it's unrecognizable. And the Germans actually brought in Russian prisoners to sort of propel or to work those rockets, and they were all, I mean, just killed. But this is what the bunkers look like to this day. And this is just 100 yards up the hill from where the plane went. No, it's a town that I cannot remember the name of, but I will, it's in my notebook. Okay. Sorry, I didn't store the French. I got old. Learn your language is young. Okay. So I just want to, I know I'm talking too much. I want to wrap up here. But we tried to match up aerial photography. And this is one of the things that it was really kind of interesting. The DPAA sort of sent us out there to find this thing. But it was only later, like my research was in archives of Earl Morris in the 19-teens, who worked at a site kind of associated with Chaco Canyon. And I had to go to the archives and ask for aerial photography because there is aerial photography of the area we're looking for in the 19 and right after July 8th. So we could actually have probably borrowed a photograph and found the plane. The only problem is there was air cloud cover. So here are the crew. Jack Bond, the tail gunner, he wasn't on the plane. He was sick that day. And I would like to say that Gerald M. Dye, the waist gunner, was the last living member of this crew, and he passed away about 2 weeks ago. But all of them have, I mean, all of them, most of them went on to live very, very long sort of lives. Remember Vernon Atkinson, I'm going to talk about him in just a second because he's the best sort of witness of what happened to the plane. I'm just going to talk a little bit more. You guys are fine. I went to flat school and I want to know how flat takes down a plane. And I only think there's maybe 16 hours of this on YouTube. I've watched it, but I do need the highlights here because I just wanted you to get an idea of what these pilots are up against. And then these are the real these are the real planes that are flying through the lands of the
Low Countries, over Germany and Italy, over Java Islands in the South Pacific.
It is tough.
This is no attempt to minimize the danger of flying. Gunners are good, particularly the Germans. Their weapons and methods are good.
Okay, so I think I took that out because, actually there were primitive computers that aligned these sort of guns. So they would be sort of tied into one another. And what the Allies were trying to find out and what so many sort of French resistance people were trying to do on the ground is find out how these computers work. Because essentially, if you were a German gunner or Russian, whoever you were, on the ground, you would dial in, you would estimate the altitude of the plane, and then you would estimate speed, and then you would estimate, and then it would do the math of it takes 1 second for a shell to go 1,000 feet. And then it would dial into a whole series of guns. And those guns would send up shells either in a wide swath of area, or they would pinpoint this box, and they had these sort of names for it, these boxes of death that would sort of just take out planes, and if they knew for sure that you were coming to that particular area. Seriously, this is the training video that they watched. I guess you got to have a sense of humor about it. But this is going through the mathematics of how Germans learned to shoot down bombers, and then how the Allies adjusted the formations, adjusted the heights. And so if you were Amy, if you were Mike, another bomber pilot, you would say that you would dive for a period of 6 seconds, then you would turn over for a period of and there were rules for how much you had to do to sort of get ahead of the computer guidance systems that were targeting these planes. And so it was this cat and mouse game. The Germans up to their game with their new and better targeting systems. The Americans had to adapt. And by the end of the war, what you saw in the formations that were being flown by the Eighth Army was completely different by what they were flying sort of at the end of the war. And what I think, what I wanted to show you was this sort of this boxed area is what I think what happened to Lieutenant Wilson on the planes that he was flying with. And I'm just going to speed this. If anybody wants to go to flat school, I'll send you the videos. Yes, continuously pointed fire. I know, right? So here's the route that they flew on this day. And you can kind of see, these are the original maps from the archives. The DPA, not the other states, we won't go for them. But anyway, so what's interesting is that one of these is what they were supposed to do. And one of these is what they actually did do. And if you look at the blue is what they actually did do. And at one point they got lost. And this is, you can imagine, they're flying on that day. The ceiling was 24,000 feet of clouds. So they would have to fly above that and then dive down below. So they have to get their bearings. There's a guy lying flat on his front in the lead plane, freezing his tuchus off and trying to sort of figure out from ground tells where he is because he's only got basic compass readings. And they got lost, and you can see that at one point they had to circle, and of course you can imagine what the German gunners can do with that kind of data. So anyway, this is sort of where they decided to go, and they were going to bomb Humier, which was there, and the idea was you do 90 degree angles so the Germans don't anticipate where you're going. And they were about 2.5 minutes from bombs away when they were shot down with that continuously pointed fire. And this was the sort of formation. And I really am almost done. I'm so sorry. So Lieutenant Peterson was the most senior officer. He was a colonel, and actually Peterson and Lamb, there were two officers, a colonel and a major. Wilson, he was a really relatively rookie pilot. He was in the third position, and Barry. And you can see how they were all sort of lined up. Those all three planes were shot down on that day and at that same time. Peterson made it all the way back to the coast of England on like basically one engine. And I think a couple of his guys were injured, but most of them were rescued on the beach. And Barry and Thornton lost 7 of the 9 guys who were in their flight, in their plane. So, oh, I did a thing with animation. I'm so sorry. So they're not flying at the same elevation. So they're flying at different elevations so they can cover each other. The tail gunners and, waist gunners can cover different groups. And this was the most efficient, the safest, and the most economical state of way to do it. So I tried to show you different patterns of where they went. And then I'm really wrapping up. I'm so sorry. I know I'm going too long. And these are the flak. These are the weapons of the Germans that are showing up, these, like 10-inch, 16-inch, and even larger shells, which are incredibly destructive. And you basically pick the altitude at which you think the flight is going, and these shells go up, explode, and shrapnel is meant to rain through the plane. And that's probably likely what killed Lieutenant Wilson. So what Lieutenant Atkinson, his co-pilot, saw was that Frankie was hit in the lower abdomen, and it was a continuous stream of blood. He tried to get out of the chair to bail out. They lost their 1 and 2 engine on their left wing. They began to bank right. They were immediate order to bail out. And as the top gunner was coming down, he had to pass through the cockpit, and he said he saw Lieutenant Wilson with eyes open, mouth open, blood all over the controls, and not breathing. But there are other stories, particularly told amongst the family, that Lieutenant Wilson was alive long enough to pilot the plane, long enough that his men could escape. I am not a historian. There are different accounts. I can only imagine the chaos of battle. So I don't know this story, but these are the idea of what the flak was going through. And it said the pilots and the crew said it sounded like sort of rain on sheet metal. But then when it got really bad, it would, it would blow out windows. It would take out your ears. And it was incredibly destructive, but the plane was by and large aluminum and it could take a lot of hits before it sort of went down, unless it was sort of quite critical. So this is the kind of banking that the crew described after the plane was hit, to give you an idea and how hard that would be and what G-forces were associated with the escape from that plane. Okay. So the cockpit was hit and several key points. One of the things that the tail gunner said was that the oxygen and the hydraulics were gone out. So they had to hand crank open things and they lost oxygen. So you're at 20,000 feet, all of a sudden you have no oxygen. That's, I think you will tell me that you passed out cold from that, right? So then there's this banking. All right, enough of all this. This is the order in which you would bail out. Here's the story of that the French wrote about and the death of the pilots, and then the safe return of one of the men by the French resistance. There are different accounts, and not to be totally overly graphic, but there are accounts that when Frankie's plane hit, that human remains were found in trees and in different areas, and that different groups came. A priest is said to have come and buried him in a nearby shrine. The French resistance was said to have come and taken the remains to a nearby copse of trees. And the Germans were said to have come and taken him and buried him in a British World War I cemetery. Unfortunately, the DPA doesn't allow us to sort of track down those oral history stories. So our duty was to just look at that field and eliminate that as a possibility for the location of Frankie's remains. And with that, I think I really will need to stop talking. Do I need to stop talking? I do. Okay. Enough stories about this. I did a whole thing. Yep. So these are just accounts. These are oral history accounts of and what you can find online. So with that, oh my, I think I went to, oh yes. Sorry, this was just in French. This was all rats. But anyway, I think this is enough to end on the epilogue of the story. And I just want to thank the DPAA for letting us do this. I think their work is critical and important. And there's opportunities for archaeologists in this room to go and volunteer or be paid on projects like this and bring additional service members home, because this work is tough and ongoing. And it and I'm hoping, I know we're going back another year. So we'll see with that. So that with that, I will stop talking. Well, thank you very much. Yes. Yes, sir. You asked without even having to be called on. You're officially the best student here.
What was the most exciting thing you found on that in France?
There was this really nice chablis from the.
That's true.
What is the most exciting thing? I think the most exciting thing was that I found out that I could do a different type of archaeology. I'm very old, and I've been doing particular kinds of archaeology for a very long time. And what this project taught me was, with really smart colleagues, I could learn different ways of doing things that I've been doing in the old ways, in new ways, and I think in good ways. You don't really beg. You need to say like a really cool bullet. Yeah, maybe part of a sword handle. Your mom and I went to the Battle of Agincourt, actually. And you know, when you get into Shakespeare in a couple years, it's good. It's like there's a whole Henry V story. He's going to strip his arm and show his wounds, and we will remember it that day.
Serial numbers.
Yeah. And parachutes, we did find, I think, part of a strap to a helmet. We don't know if it was a St. Wilson's helmet, but. But we did find evidence of, you know,
it was a different kind of
person.
It was challenging to people.
Take out that database.
Or by the words, not to for many of us.
One thing you did not want to point out about the 17th. 17th and 24th were the heavies. They also did light on the 21st. The 17th included the waste gun. Position of program. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about 30,000 feet of elevation, that's open.
Minus 50 degrees Celsius.
Yeah, and so they were wearing, yeah, that was my, they did have electrified suits to some degree.
Which they electrocuted themselves on often.
They electrocuted themselves on.
Yeah.
And so they put it in that, and so they had shielding gloves, shielding boots.
Well, bomber jacket.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For reason.
I had my uncle's bomber jacket for a while. I don't work that often now, but he flew in the city. But this happened throughout the war. He was being trained to be a firepower. So guys can get to a fire, he could be one. So everybody wanted, that was a hot plane. Right? Yeah. It took their entire pilot class of 500, or fire, entire pilot class of 500 and turned them all into bomber pilots. Then he was outfitted with all European theater clothing. So he thought, okay, I'm going to Europe. And they took off and opened their orders and they made a 180 on the South Pacific. And so all their clothes and everything went to Europe, and they got hit to be quartermastered out in the Pacific. It was absolutely. It was, you know, what those men did in the Army Air Corps in those days, not the Air Force.
Boss of my dad, he was American, or Canadian. He flew over as a Spitfire, escorting the bombers, and he was part of the 1,000 bomber run.
Oh, yeah.
That was heading to Germany.
Yeah.
And he said, it was incredible. You get up above the clouds and get into position, and all you could see was the bomber.
Yeah.
So as far as you could shoot. And it would be hours for them to cross over at a particular point.
If you'd like to read additionally about it, there was a young bomber pilot, and he wrote a book. He was a bomber pilot. He survived his 20 missions, and then he switched over to fighters, and he did not survive that element of it. But he lived on South Pearl Street, and he went to South High School, and he wrote it. His mom published his works posthumously, called Serenade the Big Bird, and it's an extraordinary writing. If you like, it's kind of that called? Serenade the Big Bird.
And what kind of fighter did he fly?
I knew you would ask me that. I don't know. I don't remember. Sorry. Other questions about?
Do we have any questions from the virtual audience?
I don't see any.
Erin, I love so much of the question as a comment. That was an excellent talk. Thank you very much. That was perfectly presented. I mean, that's really engaging. Like, really nice to
listen. You and I understand.
And I like the presentation that you give, is that, you know, it's an anatomy of an event, right? Yeah. Like, you have an event that we know all the details all around, except for this one very, very minor / major thing. Where is the guy? Yeah. You know, right? It's a mystery of like what actually happened. And we know pretty much everything around there, all the pieces, all the plot of the story, but we don't know what happened to them, you know. Whereas in archaeology, typically we know, we find the thing, and then we try to like recreate these events that happen around there. So I appreciate this is a different kind of, you know, investigation, and that we don't know the ultimate answer of what happened to the guy himself, you know.
From the oral history, because if he still had his bomb load, it would have been a massive explosion on the ground. Do they talk about that?
So these bombs were, I am told, the general they ones that armed. They were armed until, so there was not. So we know that engine ended up in Simon's dad's backyard.
Yeah.
And we know the plane disintegrated, but there was no
explosion.
And there was no crater. And even when I was looking at those aerials, and there's cloud cover over 90% of it, you can tell there's no bomb crater.
Yeah.
There, so it was either, it didn't explode, it was covered up immediately, which I doubt, or I'm kind of trusting the oral history of the young boys who pillaged that plane for years later to get pocket money for ice cream. And so I think enough of that superstructure was still intact for them to sort of know where it was. But in the course of 70 years, we've just lost exactly what happened to it. But the plane, the DPA, we don't care about the plane, right? The plane is secondary to finding Lieutenant Wilson. And that's that's the hard part, right?
Yeah.
Because we were like, can we go look at the shrine? Can we go look in the copse of trees? Could we go? And there's one account of someone found a wallet and it was given to a teacher and the teacher died and the teacher gave it to his daughter and the daughter's 89 years old she didn't remember, and so we went to go talk to, and so it's a whole different, you think I'm a prehistorian, I think historic archaeology, oh no problem, everything, no, this is just as this just the problems are just different.
We have conversations about it being incredibly personal, like how different project
made. Yeah,
and the story and family members and moms and kids, like it was a very different type of archaeology.
Don't think there are any questions online, or at least there's nothing in the chat. They might have given up.
It's still there. So if they're going back next year, is there a reasonable chance that you'll be able to go into other areas that haven't been examined before?
That is so above my our pay grades, I think I've been able to decide, because it's what the DPA wants to do and what the previous reports, and it's not something that the people on the ground decide.
Share with you.
Yeah, unfortunately. But
yeah, we were told that she's a bird bone. So
but,
and we were like, oh, okay.
But you know, there's I think there's probably a method to the madness.
There is.
Yeah.
There
we just weren't privy to it.
I was just gonna follow up. Do you know how the DPA, or what it was called, decides its priorities?
That's,
because there's with 80,000 people,
yes,
how do they decide who go after next?
I don't know all of that. I know the head of the DPA is a political appointee, so those priorities change. So for a brief period of time, I know that the DPA was intent upon raising the USS Arizona and returning service members who were hundreds of service members at that memorial in Pearl Harbor. And when that was summarily sort of denied by Congress and family members, that the expectations were greater than what DPA could provide. Because I think they were thinking, we will return 180 members this year, as opposed to 30. And so that's when the partnerships kind of were born, where the partnerships with DMNS or CSU or things like that. And I'm not sure the partnerships are going to last into the next political cycle or not. It might return to an all-army or all-military-based sort of search and rescue, search and discover kind of mission. At least that's my sense of it. But of course, I'm an outsider. I've taken the training. I did the 40 hours of training through online, which was extraordinary, in Hawaii. And but I'm just a civilian. And you know how I know civilians are not privy to a lot of the information.
Question.
Oh, you do. Sorry.
Yeah, all the artifacts. The question is, all of the artifacts were reinterred. Did anyone wish to keep diagnostic items? Was there a clear protocol?
Nope. The clear protocol was the bomb squad took anything that could explode, and those were the bullets because they went down with a full complement of bombs and the gunners, the 50 caliber. And then everything else was reburied on site. We didn't bring anything home. And that's just not the priority of the DPA. The exception was if there were anything associated with a human,
with
the person, that would have been, if it was found, would have been sent to Hawaii.
Silly trivia, you know where the term nine, the whole nine yards came from?
Oh, you're just stumping me left and right over here. It's not football?
Mm-hmm. the 50 caliber belt was 9 yards, and so when they say the whole 9 yards, it was to unload the 9 yards. Wow.
All the more reason to switch to metric. Any more? We go home. Want to go home?
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.